Town of Reading zoning bylaw. The Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, on Monday, May 22nd, 2017, at 7:30, on the petition of Arbor Green, Inc. for site plan review for a four-unit residential project on a 12,368-square-foot lot, residentially zoned tract of land located at 9092 Green Street, Assessor's Map 17, Lot 154, in Reading, Massachusetts. Copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Public Services Department in the Town Hall, Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday, from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., and on Tuesday, from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Yeah. Did you want to summarize anything, or do you want the applicant to start?
So, yeah, I'll give a little summary. The existing residential structure on this property is 5 units. The applicant has been asked to remove one of the units from the county code, and is now proposing a new 4-unit townhouse project. There are no wetlands on this property, so it didn't have a conservation review. It did have to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals for variances, which it's received. We had a DRT, all of the feedback from staff incorporated into your draft site plan decision. And Tom Bergendahl, applicant, is here.
You want to tell us about your project?
Sure. As Julie said, it was a 5-unit building. There are some egress issues on the third floor where there used to be a unit. So in redeveloping or building over again decided, because of the lot constraints especially, that 4 was probably more appropriate for that site. So we're going down to 4 units. The setback is 20 feet from Green Street, and 3 of the units will be facing Green Street. One of the units is going to be facing Elliott Street. There are a couple of pine trees that I would like to take down that are on the corner. The one especially closer to the corner, I think, is an obstruction to the vision of people coming down Elliott Street and then stopping at that four-way stop. We're going to landscape. We have a landscaping plan, so it's not as if there will be no trees on the lot. We are planting landscaping trees, I believe dogwoods and shrubs. One of the driveways comes from Elliott Street to the end unit, which faces Elliott Street. And basically it's all, you know, the building is going to be blown in insulation in the walls. I'd like to have it super insulated. It will be up to code. We are planning on having sprinklers in the building. I would also like to put photovoltaics on the roof because it's got just amazing southern exposure. The end unit will be a little bit bigger, but all pretty, I think, nicely designed by Mr. Sandors and Phoenix Architects, and we will do whatever we need to make it comply with, you know, the various sewer and other and driveway regulations and whatever else.
Where does the driveway issue stand? You have to go before the board of selectmen for that, right?
I think we're going to need some relief from the selectmen on the driveway issue, just in terms of the, especially on Green Street.
So what's, I mean, I have an issue with the one on Elliott Street, but what would the board of selectmen's issue be with the one on Elliott Street then?
On Elliott Street, I think it's they don't want the driveway on top of one of the marker stones. I think that's what they're going to say. They want us to move it sort of straighter out and get it basically a little bit farther back from the corner.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the note from the,
study is more detailed.
Traffic study, and I understand that too, but that driveway really concerns me, because I don't know the traffic level on the street. And in other locations where there's a driveway just like this at an intersection, there's all kinds of issues where they're trying to potentially, especially if they're going north on this page, right, as cars stopped at that intersection, they're coming blind to go off the page while something crossing. They're always going to be blocked in sometimes. Depends on how much traffic is there. So I'm wondering whether we need a count or something that tells us how that corner works with that driver right there. I guess if you straighten it, what do? You lose a car? If you try to straighten it, there's a tree or a pole there.
There is a pole there. There's a tree basically on the edge of the lot. But there is a utility pole, which is, I think if you straighten it, you're coming close to the pole, but you're not going to have to move. But then the issue is how you configure the driveway in light of where the catch basin is, and maybe reconfiguring the catch basin. That's kind of the issue. If it were a maple, you would have a whole bunch, 10 or 15 feet of visibility at the bottom. But with a pine, it completely fills that space.
Yeah, actually, they're closer together than the pine shows. So ZBA granting a variance on conditions that the property is unsound or needs significant maintenance to bring it up to code or whatever, right? It sounded like some of the issues were the foundation and there was significant investment required. To make it viable, I guess, I don't know, whatever. But I didn't read the ZBA decisions.
You didn't? It's in the application.
The ZBA decision?
Yes.
You're just that they it's weird to me that because that means that somebody could potentially hang on to a property for a long enough time, not do anything to it, and then claim a hardship, right amount of hardship to have to bring it back up to get relief to do a project that's different than what my.
My attorney says it's because we predated zoning and we could prove it. We have the documents from the town of Reading that prove that that was a four-family building in prior to zoning of 1941, I believe it was, or 1942. We have the town listings. So that's how we got grandfathered in as a four.
I don't, like I said, the decision from ZBA is done.
I'm not sure exactly what it is that you're saying, though.
What I'm saying is, so there's four criteria you need to meet for that. One of them is typically economic hardship, that something about the property causes an economic difficulty, but what otherwise, it's very bad.
Maintenance is.
I could tell you.
Right.
We start at the foundation and we basically go all the way up.
Right.
Peter has been astute in his observations in the foundation. He says it's a load-bearing issue. The back foundation actually is buckling out, and I've had masonry folks look at it and give me estimates, and so that's just the foundation. Then you go to the insect infestation in the structural parts, the dry rot of some of the supporting beams in the basement, the walls, the sagging floors, the electrical. I mean, we did upgrade the electrical system, but it goes on and on.
Yeah, yeah. And again, it was meant more of a general statement. ZBA's granting variances based on that, you know, hardship. If someone's had a property, let's say 20 years, and done nothing to rental property, it's kind of keep around that.
I don't know that they were granting it based on that. I think they were, I wasn't there, but the existing structure doesn't meet setbacks. So they also take that into consideration, because this applicant could voluntarily demolish this building and build it right back on that same footprint with those same nonconformities that they wanted.
It's just the one particular type of issue, if that's become too personal somewhere.
Right, but I also don't know that the zoning board has to determine that it meets all four thresholds to grant a variance.
But this is the same kind of issue we ran into in the proposal over on South Street. Because the thing that's grandfathered is the use as a four-family or a multi-family house or property, whatever you call it.
Mm-hmm.
That part is clearly grandfathered because it's an existing use prior to zoning. Now, the question about setbacks and the other things, ZBA's purview, is there, but the fact that it can be redeveloped as a multi-family house in that location is in fact grandfathered.
Yeah, I'm not disputing that.
Yeah, he's not disputing that aspect. Okay. We can talk about this further.
Yeah, this is just something to keep. I like the project.
Right. And it's clearly better than what they're at.
Much better than most townhouse developers. I don't think you want to see those trees limbed up. I think they look weird. So if you have to tell me what the odds are on keeping that tree.
There's no way to like trim it a little.
Well, actually, there are a bunch of shrubs around the corner as well.
There are.
If those went away, that would probably open up the
door. Those are going away.
Yeah. One tree was left, potentially that would have been enough.
They left the one tree and removed the shrub.
Yeah. We can start that way, and then if it becomes a problem before you start building, I guess. I mean, you have just about up until you started pouring foundations to tear the tree down.
I just don't see how that driveway on Street is really going to work, or how the
ins and outs.
Well, it's so substandard because it's actually in the radius of the turn. I just can't see that the town engineer advising the board of selectmen that that's an acceptable new curb cut. I would be surprised if he does. I understand the difficulty there because of the location of the catch basin, And then utility pole, but that's not really reason enough to create what ends up being a substandard curb cut.
We designed that so that we would avoid that catch basin system right there.
Right.
And the bound to the best we could. We are also trying to keep it off the radius. And unfortunately, we ended up coming up with this because it seems to be the path of resistance. Now we've talked to the town engineer. He suggested that we use a floor flange catch basin, get rid of the granite face block, and straighten it out, pull it further away from the intersection. They would approve of that, and we would still be able to avoid, would be well away from the utility pole, and we'd be more perpendicular to Elliott Street and put more space between the two driveways to comply. And they felt that that would be a better solution for that driveway. And where we can take that catch basin and change it so that it's sitting in the middle of the driveway and they'll approve of that, that's a great solution for that problem, exactly what you're bringing up.
Yeah, yeah.
Because we're coming right into the intersection a little too close.
Right,
I agree.
Right,
and
yeah.
Especially with the trees, if they don't go away, that's a little bit, but again, that's traffic coming from the north. So they're gonna have good sight line to anybody coming out of that driveway.
Right, I think those end up being two separate issues.
Right,
the trees and the location of the driveway, just because of the configuration there. But yeah, if that works out, I mean, that you can use the different kind of catch basin and rebuild that some and then shift it up, then I can see that working much better than what's here.
I was gonna ask if that would cost.
Yeah.
We had to propose that because we didn't think that would be, we didn't expect that to be approved. Good idea.
Yeah.
Well, better than what's here.
Sure.
Yeah.
Can you bring up the street name, Jeff? Take it into that corner.
Yeah, Google Maps, I couldn't find a clear street view on that, but maybe Jerry will have a better part.
Yeah, so if all those shrubs go away, I think that opens up pretty well.
Right.
The tree looks healthy. Do we know if the tree's okay?
It seems to be okay. The one that I do have an issue with, that I actually talked to the tree warden about, is a maple that is basically on the lot line between myself on Elliott Street, between myself and my neighbor to the north. Just because of all the branches and limbs that have been falling, and it looks like it's half dead. My thought, and the root system is pretty much where, if there were a sidewalk, it's all over where the sidewalk would be. And I actually had talked to the tree warden. I said, could you take a look at that and see if it needs, because it's just dropping stuff all over the place. See if it needs to come down. He thought it was fine, but he did send a crew in to trim back some of the dead stuff. My thought about a sidewalk is, if we did do a sidewalk, is you start digging up the roots, and that will be the death knell for that tree.
Sidewalks was the other issue. Sidewalks was the other thing the town wanted, I think, or planning stuff.
Well, they talk about the, I think the sidewalk on Green Street. Was in the notes.
And I'd be happy to do one on Elliott, but my concern is, once you start digging close to that tree, then my question is, how close can you get without doing serious damage to the roots, to a tree that's sort of barely hanging on as it is.
Yeah.
see that tree on these plans. It looks like it's right at the driveway entrance to the adjacent property.
Yeah.
I think it's on the street layout, actually, isn't it? Is it a tree planting?
Yeah, it's in the tree zone. It's definitely a top of planted tree.
So you're gonna do a sidewalk basically around the corner and up to that new driveway? Is that the plan?
Unless the selectmen say, no, we want it all the way, you know, to the neighbor's lot. But I think if they do say that, I'd have to throw in the comments of go take a look at or talk, you know, get some feedback from your tree warden about what that's gonna do. Because my guess is you're gonna push a tree that's marginal to basically gone.
That's the utility pole right there. So it looks like there's only about 8 feet, 6 to 8 feet between that pole and the tree.
Yes. Well, actually, I think it's more like 10 feet. Because believe it or not, there's a driveway in between those two. And I can't back my Ford Escape into it and my trailer. And
so I guess you could potentially come up to the, looks like a, I guess is that a turn? Radius curb on the left side of the tree.
I mean, this is the same thing, really. It's all the same issues are all over town, where here's a gap, right, in the network. You've got sidewalks coming from here, actually on both sides, all the way up Elliott Street, not on this property, and a tree is in the way. So really it comes down to what's more important. You know, it is likely that you pave here and that tree's not gonna make it. Is that okay? Maybe that's preferable. Maybe it's preferable to have the continuous sidewalk and forgo the tree and plant a new smaller one, you know, and call it that. I don't know.
I would recommend it.
The sidewalk.
Use that approach, yeah.
Yeah, the sidewalk and. But those are almost town street issues that we don't have the whole scope of everyone's priorities.
We can just put that in here as a recommendation. We would recommend that you run the sidewalk up to take out the tree, and then it will let the Board of Selectmen decide what they want for their curb cut.
Mm.
So where do we revise for the driveway straightening out? Is that on your findings still?
No, I could put that as a condition that we'll work with the town engineer to figure out a solution to the driveway. Maybe on page 5, number 3, where it says engineering concerns, at the top of the page, you can say the applicant shall also town engineer. And your primary concern is that it needs to be straighter.
Yeah, it needs to come off.
And a little bit off the curb. I mean, off the turn.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, it doesn't matter to me whether it's straighter. It needs to be out of that.
Right.
on that. Number 11 on page 3.
Yeah, that's where we probably want to put in a recommendation for the remove the ground level.
So you're recommending that they just keep that one big tree and maybe remove shrubs at least as a start?
And the second tree looks like it might be starting to get too close to the project, the building.
Does this need to be sprinklered?
Yes.
It does. Yeah, in the proposal.
Well, it's required.
It's 4 units.
4 units, yeah.
There was a question in here about the water service, the 2-inch. Is that the fire department determined that that's adequate for the sprinkling?
We haven't talked to the fire department about that. They may require a separate line for the sprinkler. They may require individual lines for houses, each unit, but we haven't worked that out yet.
Okay.
If they require a separate line, we'll just bring in a separate line.
Yeah. Don't you always require a separate line from domestic and fire?
I thought so, but there was a comment made that it may not be necessary. I did think so.
Okay, so we know what we want. How do we accomplish it?
Well, I think Julie's already marked up the comments, right?
Mm-hmm.
There are really only the two comments. There's the comment about the trees and the findings. There's a comment in the conditions under engineering concerns about working with them to straighten out the driveway.
There's number 16 on page 3 as well. I don't know, Tom, if you have any information about mechanical units. Are there going to be any in the yard?
Oh, yeah.
On the exterior. I believe we're using the basement for the mechanical units, as in furnace, air conditioning, like that.
Okay, so you're not planning on an external condenser for split air conditioning, or
that's a good thing.
We may have that. We may have to have one of those in the other patio in the yard. We may have to. We don't have our system fully designed yet, but it's possible.
Sorry, what was your name?
Peter Sandors.
So maybe we'll put a condition that if they have any mechanicals in the yard, they need to be properly screened. I don't know.
Just put them on the north side.
What kind of sound attenuation might be needed depending on how close the north side? Isn't that the one that's right up against the?
They're not going to be any noisier than anybody else's house air conditioning.
Does that make it right?
Right.
That makes it something that everybody deals with.
Okay.
Yeah.
The ones I have are super quiet.
Yeah, I mean the
can't hear them.
The
yeah,
modern
putting a 6-foot high wood fence, so that's
right.
Okay. Screening or none?
Well, I think they shouldn't be on the front of the property, right? So they should definitely be on the back. And then if they're visible from the street, you could say that they're screened. If there's a 6-foot fence along the back, then the neighbor won't see them.
Yeah.
So potentially the easternmost unit might have it, you know, at the top of the driveway or by the garage, potentially.
Yeah, usually if they have the pad mounted systems, they're butted up next to the side of the structure because they want a minimum run.
Yeah, if you're using the regular ones where the fan's blowing up, you can tuck them in. But if you're using, say, like a new
six inches. They're also a lot narrower. My brother installed a four-unit system down in his house in Connecticut last fall, so.
I can't imagine you're gonna install multiple splits and then have the outdoor units mounted on the second floor wall, so I guess the units should all be mounted at ground level if they're.
Right.
I hate to do that, but if they're not mounted at ground level, then you'll have to figure out attenuation and screening. You know, like after the fact installation, they just put them up at the unit sometimes, so.
Yeah.
Stuck on the wall. I can't imagine you would ruin your building like that.
Lighting, what did, did you have anything? I mean, there's a lighting plan here, but I don't see anything on it. I mean, maybe I'm just not reading it right.
There's like little, it's not a photometric, it's lighting location.
So it's, is it all just, it's gonna be like sconces and, you know, typical?
Yeah, I did a few cut sheets.
Oh, okay.
Yep. So there's no area lighting on the exterior at all?
No.
Anything else?
I was wondering about the utilities, the comment from the town engineer about the shared sewer service. And if you know whether you're proposing gas for the building?
Yes, on the gas, and I believe that Steve has been talking with the engineer about redoing the sewage.
Talking to Ryan?
Right.
Okay.
Actually, I was talking to Ryan, but maybe Peter.
Peter, yeah.
And he suggested going through the back of the sewer and set the manhole up where that shed is to be removed and connect into the line from the back of the building.
Okay.
At each unit.
And then coming back out to the street?
Or then coming out to Elliott.
Out to Elliott. Porch lights are just hanging versions of this, or are they recessed lights?
We were debating that. I think it might be nice if those were recessed, and these kind of what you see. The other one's more utilitarian.
So that light is not going to comply with dark sky?
This one?
Yeah. Like, if it's not fully cut off. From here, it doesn't look like it. So I have a condition in here that it should be dark sky, comply with, be fully shielded. So if they're going to propose that and you're going to accept that, then we should get rid of this condition.
Why isn't it comply? Because the light comes out the side? It's like the source is under the cap.
Is it? I'm just seeing it for the first time from here, so.
exposed,
Exposed bulbs.
Exposed bulb in residential, to me, it's too much, like, it does more than just light up the area, it creates all this glare that's sort of unnecessary, and I think it usually looks nicer when it's, like something like this, it may be, recessed, hanging, like you said, hanging, recessed from the street, but then when you get up, you can see the detail. But when it's glass with exposed bulb along the front, and you're walking, you know, you're walking or driving, and all you just see, like, it's just on these,
yeah,
you know, as opposed to like a frosted glass where it dims it out. So.
Yeah, it's a double one,
but
a double driveway.
But you see that all over. I mean, everyone does it, and I. It's the style that I just
these guys
don't
have to
think.
Go through site
yes.
plan review.
Yeah.
So I guess so. I guess we want to talk about it that way because there are people who put their motion sensor spots facing straight out.
Yeah.
And just like flood that guy's house next door.
Right.
Most of these look like they're underneath the return eave, you know, on the gables of the driveway. If you look at the rendering.
Yeah. Well, it's the two, right? You have them on either side of the garage.
Yeah.
So, the leftmost driveway and the next one, both of those, the lights look like they're under the gable return. So, if you drew a section through there, you might get a dark sky benefit because the roof overhang is going to block the light.
Yeah.
The next
right.
driveway is underneath the overhang. See it? Except the door's
yeah.
recessed. And I don't know what the street with the Elliott Street one looks like. It's probably just the same return. These are all switched individually.
Yes.
So I was gonna say you could cut out the double lights. I would see if you can submit something to Julie maybe that has, if this has a glass option to cut back some of that glare or maybe a bigger, cap,
yep.
Or find out if this complies with dark sky.
Well,
No, I'm okay with it. I mean, we're going eco on this. He's super insulating it. He wants to put some solar on it. Like I said, the third door there works. It's recessed under the soffit.
I would prefer it if the light fixtures would comply.
Yeah, that's what I was just saying.
Yeah.
You submit something that either proves that this does, or something that cuts down on the glare, or something that complies with dark sky. Comments from the public? Okay.
Move that the CPDC close the public hearing for site plan review at the project at 1992 Green Street.
All in favor?
I'll second it.
That's right. It's the voice in my head.
And I think we've captured the modifications to the draft decision.
Yeah, Julie, you captured the lighting?
Yeah.
Move that the CPDC approve the site plan review decision for the project 90 Green Street as amended.
Second.
Before we vote on that, do we have to vote individually on the waivers? We just add it to the motion that the waivers were all...
Including the waivers, yeah, unless you feel strongly that something shouldn't be.
Well, I was going to ask for a traffic analysis, but if we're moving the driveway, if we're going to straighten that back out and get it away from the curb, then that's really the best you can do there. So.
Right.
Get it further away from the intersection, I think is best.
Okay. wait to see it.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I'll send you a finalized version of this tomorrow.
Sounds good.
I haven't seen these, I was just looking from afar.
John's right, when you drive past the house.
I don't like the exposed bulb at all.
They're just, there's so much glare coming off of those, especially these two right here.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. I think it's just better in general to have a standard for site plan review.
It's a little confusing because.
Lighting is.
But dark sky is not really, it's not necessarily a thing.
It's not everything, because it's only protecting.
Well, did you read the condition where I outline exactly what I'm talking about? Is that not? Because I can change that.
Can you take 5 minutes or 3 minutes?
If I'm not capturing like the wording correctly or whatever, I should just change it.
Next up is 162 Main Street. It says 62 Main Street. Anybody notice?
Yeah.
Notice is hereby given that pursuant to sections 4.3 and 4.6 of the Town of Reading zoning bylaw, the Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Main Street, Reading, Mass, on Monday, May 22nd at 8 p.m. on the petition of 162 Main Street Reading Trust for a site plan review for a mixed-use project on a 23,815 square foot commercially zoned tract of land located at 162 Main Street, Assessor's Map 7, Lot 116 in Reading. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Public Services Department in Town Hall on Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday, 7:30 to 5:30, and on Tuesday, 7:30 to 7 p.m.
The king is here.
For the record, my name is Brad Latham. I'm here with Chris and Mike Duion, who are in the second row, as well as Jack Sullivan, who's the project engineer, and Nancy Toomey, who's the project architect. As was stated in the legal notice, and you've seen in the application, we're dealing with 162 Main Street, situated on the westerly side of the street, and a little under 24,000 square feet of land. Property rises significantly towards the back from the street. Historically, this property was used for Gregory's, which was a combination of a sit-down restaurant, a takeout restaurant. They also had an ice cream place. They sold Richardson's ice cream during the summertime. So it had a pretty high traffic use. The proposed use of a retail repair facility affiliated with Doyon's would be a much lesser traffic than involved in the past. He purchased this property about 5 years ago and want to enhance its appearance as well as make it more usable for their particular purpose. What I'm going to ask is if Jack could describe some of the basic engineering features, in addition then ask if Nancy could describe the architectural changes to the building itself. I'm more than happy to answer any questions.
For the record, Jack Sullivan, Sullivan Engineering Group. On this project, we did have a DRT meeting with the town, and it's pretty straightforward. In the proposed condition, we're looking to add a new water service, a new sewer service, and a new gas service. The utility works was permitted already, and it's already in place. So that's works completed, but I did want the board to know there'd be new utilities coming into this property. On the right-hand side of the building, we're showing a proposed loading zone. There'll be a dumpster and recycling area situated to the rear of the addition. Presently, the dumpster sits out in the front left corner of the site, so the town was happy to get that out of that location and get into a more suitable location on the site. And really what we tried to do is we tried to add some landscaping to the front. The curb cuts, there's two existing curb cuts on the site. They don't remain two curb cuts, but we're adding some landscaping in the area where the dumpster is now. There'll be some landscaping added. We're gonna raise landscaped island in the center here with some plantings. And we're really looking to formalize the parking situation on this site. So we have more than enough parking for the use. As Brad said, it's a mixed use. There is a residential apartment associated with this, with the mixed use. We're putting a van accessible handicap parking space. We have some parking spaces in the front, and then we have some parking spaces in the back as well. As far as drainage for this project, by adding some of the landscaping that we're adding, we removed impervious surface from the site, so in the post-development scenario, we have less impervious area than the pre-development. Therefore, in talking with the town engineer, no formal drainage system had to be engineered for this project. So with this method, it's a low impact way of trying to reduce runoff from the site, and we achieve that in landscaping needs. I should note, in the existing conditions, we had a platform and steps over here. That's being removed. DRT meeting, we had talked to the fire department about that, so they were comfortable by removing this. They'd be able to get in along with the side of the building if need be. It's, tight, but we're making it a better situation than it is today with the platform and steps. And that's really better. One thing that did come up is there's an existing concrete retaining wall that actually sits on the Doyen Appliance property at 172. We were looking to add a guardrail to that because we're elevated over the Doyen Appliance parking lot. It's really just a safety measure, and they could technically go and do that today without any sort of permit. And in talking with Chris before the meeting, it said there was a comment if we could make something look a little more appeasing than a steel guardrail, because you would need steel for any sort of, if a vehicle was to hit it. We were thinking of maybe doing like a cable wire system like you see on the highways now. So with the wire, it wouldn't be as visually impactful. You wouldn't see it as much, so that's one thing we're looking to do. And I'll turn it over to Nancy for the architectural.
Nancy Toomey Design. I'm sure everybody's been to Gregory's before for an ice cream. The intent here is to, and this is, that was that facility, and the first thought was to leave it, but it has no foundation, so that's going. We're adding on, if you could go to the next one, we're going to add on, in addition to the side, that's the apartment upstairs. It's a brick structure, and that remains. This door is in platform is what's being removed. This is their two legal means of egress right now, so it really isn't the ideal situation. So getting rid of this makes sense, and then that at the back becomes the second means of egress, which makes a lot more sense. So if those egresses are separated. The plan for the first floor is there's a space over here that was, I don't even think it was dug out. We're going to put the two bathrooms that are necessary for the space. It's going to be an appliance repair facility. It's not often that people bring things in. I guess mostly it's microwaves or things that are easily carried. Most will come on a truck and be dropped off at a little bit of a platform back here and brought in. And this is where they'll be fixing most of the appliances. To make this work visually, we've added a porch across the front with a low roof, trying to marry a low roof structure on the side with a two-story structure in the middle. This will be wood frame. This is existing brick with concrete block. You could go to the next slide. Second floor, again, this stays. This is all roof, just shows the roof connecting through. New deck back here to get into the main area, and then this is the egress that goes out of the bedroom for a second means of egress out of the apartment on the second floor. Next slide, please. So elevation-wise, at the front, the idea is to gain a low roof that connects back. This is that brick facade that's right now just two stories. This will remain vinyl, but they'll re-vinyl it. This is vinyl on this side. This is a lot of foundation showing on this side structure that was added at some point. So the intent is to do a little bit of planting in here with a tree and maybe some kind of a fence against that concrete block to break it up, really, and give it a little bit more character. You can see that the site is somewhat straight and then tends to slope down towards the Doyen's appliance. This is that guardrail. So this is where they'll be coming in mainly for dropping off. That's that little loading dock, and then the back is almost a half a level up. So these stairs will give access to the back parking to come in and get access into their appliance repair. So truly the intent was to try and get a good piece of structure that they can use for a repair facility and also make it look as if it belongs. And the other elevations. So this is the rear with the new steps up to the door. This is the existing door, the little bit bigger landing at the back. And then this is the other side where we're taking that door out to facilitate that driveway going up to the second floor, second to the back. You can see here quite a bit of a rise by the time you get to the back.
Comments? Anything from the board?
Well, the, noted on the plan is the so-called the 30-foot zoning transition area. And I was a little surprised, it would be nice if we, the pavement, which is in the, on the, whatever it is, S-20 side of that transition line were removed. I mean, you lose probably three or four spaces, but I'm not sure that you need them from a numerical point of view.
Which space? Are you talking about the ones at the back of the site?
Yeah.
The existing parking lot.
Yes. Those spaces have been there for years.
Well, I understand that they've been there for years.
They'd like to continue to have them to have adequate capacity in the back area. One of the, we saw a copy of a draft decision, and that made a recommendation that any commercial vehicles not be parked in front, be parked in back, and that would facilitate that and still give adequate parking for the residents up there. So that's what we'd like to be able to leave those spaces.
Has there been any determination as to the number of commercial parking places that you're interested in maintaining? I don't know offhand how many trucks he has or where they might be parked on the other properties.
There's seven service trucks that the town asked us to park out back at the end of work hours. So we need the space for the service trucks, and then the tenant upstairs needs space.
Okay.
So that's kind of why we want to just leave it as it was, so we can keep all the trucks out back and make it look better.
Yeah, it's a little bit tricky for the board to deal with this because it's apparently a blended use across two adjacent properties, but we don't have the information for the existing property in this proposal.
When you said the blended, you're talking about the Doyon retail store?
Yes. It's basically the use, the retail store use, and you just gave an example of it, is depending on the availability of the adjacent property, common ownership, but it's not a part of the proposed project.
Yeah, actually, it's not common ownership. It is the Doyon family as a whole that has involved different members in each site, but legally they're two different owners. And of course, the up to about 3 years ago, the retail facility was solely on 172. And so this is just to enable them to better service by having a separate repair facility right next to the retail facility.
That we understand.
I like that the trucks will be in the back, frankly. And because it's existing pavement, I don't have an issue with it. Also, it's sloping east instead of, like west towards the residence. What is the site water storm management? Is there nothing? Is it just sheet overflow to the street? Is there anything that captures the water?
Can you zoom in on this one area, Julie?
On the existing?
I can't remember.
On this one?
Yes.
Is that better? Or?
I keep going. Oh, there's a drain manhole. Yeah, there's no formal drainage system on site. I do show a drain manhole here, but I don't see any sort of catch basin, it just sheet flows.
Kind of going towards the corner of your new addition.
Yeah, it moves this way, it kind of moves.
Yeah, but in the back.
In the back?
Back, it's heading right for your corner, right where it's going to leak. You don't have any basement though, right?
There's
You're
a, ca- there's a
it's
catch basin over here,
right.
So
it's
like,
yeah.
Oh,
it's all slab on
grade. So is the intent really for any customers to park in the front and then service vehicles and staff to park in the back plus the residential?
Yes.
You don't need any regrading to hit that loading zone? The northern edge of that doesn't slope?
You slide over to the
significantly.
Proposed condition.
is there a fence between the two? I'm trying to remember. I think there was a fence there, right?
We actually, Nancy and I coordinated on this, and I apologize. We designed this a few months ago, so trying to come back to it. But you can see I have an existing spot grade of 104.7. Nancy matched that, and that's how we came up with the number of steps we needed to go up to the upper parking lot. We're basically hitting this grade right on here. See how we added two steps here? So we're matching the grade here. In order to match these grades, we had to put these two steps in to get up to the walkway under the porch.
Yeah, I guess my concern is right at the property line on that north side, right? Is the lot sloping so much to the north?
Here, are you talking about?
Well, no, from the street. Drive a truck into the loading zone.
Okay, into the loading zone.
Yeah, so the northern side of that, isn't that sloping? I'm trying to remember.
This, right here, just like this?
Yeah, it goes like this and up, and so this is 102 here.
You're gonna back a truck into here.
And this is 103 by the time you get here, and then 104. So it is going up.
It seems slow. It just seems like this edge falls off.
It does fall off. You've got that retaining wall in there. It is kind of a funky bend, but I think that it works.
Do you think a wire guardrail is going to do it? That's actually stronger than a...
We were trying to come up with something trying to come up with something more visually appealing. It's hard to do because you need a steel guardrail. We were trying to think of something else we could do. And Chris has said he's seen them along the highways. They're going with the wire now, and if it's rated for that use, it's something that we thought might look better. We're not opposed to the steel guardrail.
No, I would prefer not. I would prefer different than the steel as well. What about timber? You can't do it in timber?
If they won't let you, can't.
Really? Okay.
I've tried that before, like a wooden guardrail, but they're not rated.
Well, no.
They look better. But
certainly, but
yeah, I've tried them on within right-of-ways, and they don't let me use them.
The new Department of Transportation guardrails with the cables are very unobtrusive. I mean, they're dark in color. You only have three strands, I think, across. They're all over northern part of 95 now. They really are good.
Yeah, but what kind of vertical support do you need?
Yeah.
You're going to have to go through that, the front of the foundation wall. Are you going to hit any of the tiebacks? You know, what are you doing to the foundation? How's that foundation wall formed? What is it?
It's
concrete.
It's under tension all the time. So it's going to be pretty hard.
Yeah.
Is it a port wall, Chris?
It's a port wall.
But it was done 20-something years ago, so I don't know about 25.
Yeah, and you're also carefully discussing the construction on the adjacent property. I mean, because that retaining wall is not on the property.
That's correct. It's not.
Really, the only issue I have with this is the application.
Sorry?
I'm all for this, right? I think it's great, it'd be nice and everything, but I'm really concerned that the application is all about 162 and there's work on 172.
Well, actually, the interesting thing, the work on 172 doesn't require a site plan review.
The dumpster enclosure for 162?
Well, the wall, first of all. The
guardrail, no. The guardrail.
So the dumpster is only for 162.
I understand, but the work is on 172.
Well, I'll tell you why that came about, and we can discuss it if you'd like. The R&D is recycling and disposal, so that they, on their main facility, Chris was describing it to me tonight, they have one dumpster, and they pay someone to take it all away, and then off-site they separate the recyclable from the trash. The advantage of doing it this way is it's done right on site. Because of that, it's a little bit wider, so it's like 2 feet over the line. So they could go back to the classic method of just having one dumpster that's all on site. In essence, I'm not really sure that kind of a square footage even triggers site plan review on 172. If you look at the threshold where you need site plan review, you look at 172 alone, which is really the issue, it's not above the threshold.
Well, the issue isn't necessarily that we need a site plan review on 172. The the issue is that we can't necessarily approve the site plan for 162 without the required work on the adjacent property.
Well, they, if you want, they could, as I say, they, for the purpose of approval, they could change the dumpster, then come back and get permission for the dumpster to go 3 feet onto the abutting property. They say the railing itself does not require a site plan review. It's above below the threshold. So all we're really talking about is that encroachment of 2 or 3 feet of the dumpster.
So no, it's a technicality. That's all it is.
I
am all for the two dumpsters. I'm all for the two dumpsters. I'm all for the nice guardrail. Really, I'm just thinking about this.
Actually, wouldn't that be a minor modification?
Yes.
If we change this for the time being to be a combined dumpster, it's going to all be on 162. Then come back and seek a minor modification, administrative approval, to convert the dumpster.
That'd be fine.
Look, I don't understand why we can't just say something like, you know.
Because you didn't notice it, though. I don't know.
Yeah,
no,
we don't have anything from the owner of the.
You didn't even let me finish.
Yeah.
My only concern with 172 not being included is that we didn't notice this correctly. That is my one concern. The fact that these.
Who owns? Where's the owner of 172?
He's right behind me.
And do we have anything saying that, he's the owner and we're giving this proposal approval to build on that? There's a couple of, it's not just the notice.
Sure.
I mean, there's a couple of.
If you are willing to grant approval, you could add a condition saying we must give that proof to the planning director within 7 days.
Yeah, whatever would expedite it, really.
Right.
I'm not trying to stop it. I'm thinking ahead. This is a technical issue where another applicant comes in with another project and says, their parking fits, it just happens to overhang the next door neighbor, and I can't approve that.
Understood.
That's all.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I mean,
it's
a great plan. I mean, we're looking forward to it, but we don't want to shoot ourselves in the foot in the future.
Understood.
So do you think that would work? We're just condition it that they submit some.
So your issue is that both applicants didn't sign, and that it wasn't properly legally noticed because we didn't.
Yeah, it's a technical issue on the application.
I'm just trying
to
be clear on what your concern is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, and there's some concern that if given that the guardrail is required from the loading space to the adjacent property. We want something in this decision that says
right.
There should be
I had
be
proposed
one.
Some ways of solving this problem. I did not realize they weren't under common ownership, these two lots. I thought they were owned by the same entity.
Same
so.
Family.
That's fine. That guardrail, though, are you gonna engineer that?
No, I won't be, but someone will be.
All right.
A structural engineer would.
All right, and that person's going to work with the building inspector, because I'm just thinking that when you start coring these down, you might hit the toe of that. Retaining wall can come back several feet.
Right.
Not several feet. It's probably almost half the wall, time and a half the wall, right? Something like that. If that wall is 4 feet high, that footing might come back 8 feet. You start coring into it potentially with whatever vertical supports you need for that guardrail. All right. So, Julie, did you want to talk about the language that you wrote up?
Well, I'm not sure that it's acceptable because I wasn't aware until this very moment that they're not actually under common ownership.
Okay.
So.
I have something else.
Yeah.
Sure. Go ahead.
So, when I look at this site, one of the things that stands out to me is the two extremely large, the double extremely large curb cut. I guess it's a shame that nothing, I mean, that's going to remain, especially with the decrease in traffic, because there's even less need for two curb cuts here.
John, I agree with you. And the reason we're not changing it is, you know the reason. It's Mass DOT. They'd make me make it larger than what it exists now, because we've been through this before. But I agree with you. What I actually try to do is, that's why I added this landscape bit, to try to.
And I guess that's where I was headed, is is, can you describe a little bit, because it's hard to really sort of understand from just this site plan, like, is that, to me, that seems sort of like this small, because we see them on the rest of Main Street. What's attempted to be a nice little island ends up being sort of like someone drives a truck over it, it's all gritty,
yeah.
The landscaping, I mean, it ends up being looking worse than just having it paved. And, you know, I guess that's what I'd like to see here is little bit more detail. Maybe it is a little bit more raised up in that area than just a six-inch curb, or because I don't think you're going to have a whole lot of problem there with trucks and traffic there. But I get not making it bigger.
And that's the idea. It would be a six-inch raise, concrete curbing, and you can see for cars pulling in when they back up, they're not going to be backing over this. I have plenty of aisle width. But and it was also an area to put the freestanding sign, you know, so there'd be landscaping, and there's a signpost over here now that we get relocated with signage.
I guess.
So you don't have to go to DOT to put this island in?
It's not on that.
No, it's
property.
Not on. It's within the private property.
All right.
I guess what I'd like to do see is something a little bit more substantial. I think in other places along Main Street with similar little islands, whether it's been a higher, almost like a raised bed. So that it's a little bit more substantial and doesn't just get washed away in the snow plows and.
Can you just mound it up though? Can you mount it way up, put the 6-inch curb and then come way up with the planting? Because if you think about the one that's a little further up the street, they've got sort of a block wall built out around their sign, and it just gets hit all the time, and it looks even worse because it's all. Falling apart.
How wide is this though?
This is like at least 20 feet, right?
No.
Or deep.
Deep.
Which
I'm sorry,
is
deep, yeah.
It's only seven to eight feet deep.
What?
It's not even 10 feet deep.
Yeah.
Might have the ability, if it's a concern, to make it deeper. As long as I have, you know, 24 feet from the edge of this parking stall to here, I could maybe increase this area.
You think the trucks will come in from the southbound entrance and go straight in, or are they going to be coming in from the northbound, having to make the turn around and then go to the?
They're headed to the back, I would expect them to take the left-hand side.
Yeah, that's why I made it the way I did, because with this loading space, if they come backing out, we don't want them backing out onto Main Street, so we want them to be able to back out and then turn out this way. That's why I left so much room there. So,
yeah.
Probably should leave it that way.
I think they're going to back in, though. I would think they're going to come in and back in. Otherwise, they won't be able to get 15 feet wide. They'd have to park along one edge and then try to get the thing out the front edge and bring it around the back.
I just think it's a missed opportunity to do something a little bit nicer along South Main Street. It's still going to look pretty
Well, it depends. We've got on the southerly side of the island, the elevation it shows here is like 104, and it's about a 2-foot difference to the other side. So as long as the 6-inch reveal is from the higher plateau,
It's just a curb, it'll slope, it's not a wall. But there'll be plantings in there. You think tall plantings or there are shrubs maybe, not just ground cover? Would that fill it up?
It could. I mean, but if you look at what they've done next door, that's not, you know, versus down in the gas station where it is another, you know, it is 12 feet deep, maybe even more, where they are able to put decent sized bushes in there and make it substantial. The same thing about the other side up at Latchey's, how do we say that, which is a good 20 feet deep, which you don't have here. But, you know, it just adds that more, it softens that stretch up.
I'm going to pull it up in Street View.
Sure. Yeah, I think if you landscape it with something taller than what's under your current sign, under the Doyon sign, it's just sort of some, like, low ground plants.
We would only want plantings, you know, 12 to 24 inches high at mature height for sight distance,
yeah.
too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, we don't want to get up 36 inches or higher, we'd be creating a safety issue.
Right.
Yeah, but you are back behind the
sight
line, right?
But there's a sidewalk there, so if you know what I'm saying, so
yeah,
they could creep up, but we don't want to plant anything too high.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually about the length. It's probably the size of that dark spot there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because in context also, and this isn't your fault, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you, if you do a 180 spin on that, Julie, you see that right across the, there's another beautiful stretch of pavement. I mean,
could you plant a tree in the island? You think a tree would survive in that island?
In the island, we
so again,
those.
That's not that's.
Oh, but we have the sign right in the middle.
With the combination
right.
of the two,
that's right.
There's this little
yeah.
spot here that just.
Well, what you're proposing will certainly be an improvement.
If there was something we could have done with the curb cuts, John, we could have had a lot more options for the landscape.
No, I understand that. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. And I wouldn't suggest to go through that any
try.
But I guess what I'm suggesting is to try and increase the width of that or the depth of that as much as you can to increase that landscape.
I would try to make its presence a little better than those sort of islands that are on the current property, on 172, which not really doing much.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
Comments from the public? So do we think we have a path with some language? Get past that technicality? Do we think we have a way to get past this issue about the 172 property stuff?
Oh, sure, about 172? It would seem to me that the language could state that within 7 days, the applicant shall provide proof to the satisfaction of the planning director that there is consent from the owner of 172 to have the guardrail and the dumpster be as shown on the site plan.
What do you think, Julie?
It's fine with me.
I think that works.
Okay.
Something similar for e-cars.
Right. E-cars for
very something
yeah.
between e-cars and perfectives. I think with screen with.
Okay.
Right.
shoveling.
It would include the guardrail and the dumpster, or just the dumpster?
Put them both in.
It could be both.
What about lighting? Did you have lighting on here somewhere?
Yeah, I think, what we were, I think just to plan to there. The existing lighting on the main, residence is, is it like the last two plans? Do we have any more? These are the last two. Oh, okay, very good, because there's not much lighting. There you go. There's one by the door. There's an existing, and these are motion activated in the back. The only additional one would be the one, that goes into the loading dock. That would be time oriented to get in and out of the building. That's the only new one. The rest stay the same. There's one up here that we're taking out. It doesn't make sense to have that. There's plenty of light from the parking from the street.
Okay.
And Lashes has lighting, I think, along the side. So it doesn't appear that we need anything more.
You're not going to light
under
the
lighting under the.
Oh, I'm sorry. And there's
porch.
Underneath, thank you.
The,
underneath
the
farmer's porch.
Time of business.
Yeah,
there's
recess.
That's, yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Because that will make it look nice.
That will make it look
yes.
very nice,
yes.
yeah. And that will be on during the business hours.
Got a little bit of every material here. Stucco, brick, siding. Oh, there we go. Recessed. Captured the guardrail type. Signage is not included in this, or is that sign included? We saw an image of it.
Yeah. I apologize. I didn't realize I had it until I was about to go home and be sick for the entire weekend, so too late. But here it is, and they will have to submit a sign permit application for it. So.
CPDC closed the public hearing for the proposed project at 162 Main Street.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the site plan review decision for the project at 162 Main Street as amended.
Second. All in favor?
The waivers.
With the waivers, including the appropriate waivers. Yes.
Yes, second. I still second it. All in favor? Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. That will look
Chair,
good.
I think you forgot the public portion of that meeting.
I asked if there was public comments.
I didn't forget it.
Missed it.
I continued public hearing for 136 Haven Street LLC. And it looks like we have a request for a continuance. Sure.
We're requesting one more time, and this should be the final time, that the hearing be continued. As you probably know, it's a historic building, and Mass Historic Commission has a protective covenant on the site. So we're going through iterations, trying to satisfy them. We need to get that done as a threshold matter, because we don't want to present something to you that we know is not going to be accepted. So that's why we asked for the continuance, and I think was the last meeting in June?
June 26th.
We get asked to be continued to that date, and our request letter that we filed with you and the town clerk grants an extension of time and requests an extension of time to the end of July.
So we're going to have a meeting on June 22nd?
June 26th.
June 26th. And then maybe one meeting after that to come up with a decision?
Well, we'll hopefully get a further extension of time if needed.
Sure.
Sorry, they're asking if July is all the time they're going to have, and I said they'll hopefully be granted an additional extension of time if needed.
Oh, yes, absolutely. We expect this to go two sessions, maybe three sessions.
Okay.
I mean, this is a significant project. We expect it's going to take some time.
Okay. Then I'd be okay with this.
Move that the CPDC continue the public hearing for the project at 136 Haven Street until June 26th at 7:45.
7:30 is fine.
7:30 is fine? Okay.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Planning updates.
So I have one other, the Chili's request for an extension of their minor modification.
That's right.
It just came in last week.
That's right. So Chili's, remember they came in for all those branding improvements and signage
right.
changes? That looks like they want an extension. They're finally going to act on it, but they want.
And they've made some modifications to what they're doing. A lot of them are based on what you requested 2 years ago. So I had them like redline that, and so I would know what was updated.
This is nice.
This is very nice.
Yeah. I was like, I'm not going through the history of this, the crazy file saving system that happened 2 years ago and trying to figure this out. Like, you tell me what you're doing. So, yeah.
Okay, so they're asking, let's see, for how long an extension?
Just 1 year is, and I think that's all you can grant. And I think they're hoping to get started pretty soon, so. I have some images if you want to see like what the new.
Sure.
Yeah. So. Just let me know. I can pull up anything you want to look at.
That's the awning change in the front there, where they're just doing like a black awning. Solid black, no graphics.
Right.
Yeah, they're gonna do some more non-illuminated. So actually there's less illumination, it looks like.
Right.
And they're not gonna build the little structure.
is sign on rear facade that.
It's this.
Oh.
It's on. I think there was something else in its place that they were proposing originally, like an actual red chili, maybe?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a pepper, halo lit pepper.
Design seems a little more modern to me, like.
Yeah.
In some ways, a little sleeker, less gaudy, maybe.
Well, it's the trend, right?
Yeah.
It is.
It's not really fast food, but
yeah.
They have to sort of sell it as more than just that.
An experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, Wandersbrook experience. That's the name of our new green triangle.
Wabro.
Wabro.
Wabro North.
Move that the CPDC approve the permit extension for the minor modification at Chili's Bar and Grill, 70 Walkersburg Drive.
Do we need to take public comments on this one?
If you want. Tony might probably has some nuggets.
No, this is the first time I've seen it in the last 2 years, so.
Okay.
It's less illuminated.
That's good.
Right. Less glowing red chilies at your house.
At everyone, really. Okay,
I'll get a second.
All in favor?
Okay. So I'll give them the extension and I'll modify what's allowed based on what they're proposing. Great. And then you have the plans for Randall Road.
We have the plans over there to endorse. Okay, so we'll start doing that. Do we have to stamp that too or just sign it?
Just signing it is fine.
Sign and date, okay.
Yeah.
I'll go first. Sign them all too, right?
Yep.
Is it multiple copies or is it?
It's two copies, yeah. I think they're technically only required to file the one, like, site layout lotting kind of plan, but.
Eight sheets.
Okay.
Do they all need sign?
I've
been asked to have to sign them all. There's is a pen.
Yeah, I gave him the pen. I didn't know if there was another pen. We could split it up, but.
Oh, I can get one. I have like 100 of them on the desk.
Quest to the future. 100-year signatures.
We didn't get minutes, right? Anything else? Any other planning updates?
I can think of.
Is
drawing
Haven,
a blank.
Is Haven the only big thing coming?
Well, you are expecting Zero Harold Ave to not a huge thing, but I haven't heard word from town council yet on the access rights opinion, so.
Any update on a certificate of occupancy for Perfectos?
They're working towards their final inspections. That's
5 years in the making or something?
Split this up?
Sure.
And then there's talk of a bookstore going into the Orange Leaf space. I'm sure you guys have heard that on social media.
I don't really do that stuff, but like a coffee shop type bookstore or just a bookstore?
No, just a bookstore.
Those are those paper things.
I shouldn't say just a bookstore. I don't like the word just. It's a bookstore. Yeah, does anyone remember what books are?
Careful. I worked in the library starting in grade school.
I know, I worked in libraries a lot in my life.
I learned the Dewey Decimal System.
Yeah, so did I.
There's nothing else. Anything else?
May I make a comment?
Sure.
Find your other one from John Street. Mr. Chairman, I just have to point out, I'm correct. I think the sign for the proposed development at 162 Main Street is 22 and a half feet high, as opposed to 20 feet exempt for a regulation.
So we don't actually have a proposal. They have to fill out a sign permit application, and at that point, we would allow it to be more than 20 feet tall.
Just the one I
thought. Yeah, so I honestly didn't even realize I had that till I was posting stuff on Google Drive. And I was like, oh, I do have a sign. Well.
Okay.
So,
we'll make sure that that's all set.
Yeah, once we get the application, it'll be fine.
And it goes
they're
by.
They're not going to allow it.
We'll make that to base.
It goes by existing grade, so they can't mount it.
Yeah.
Existing grade of the site.
All right. So if there's nothing else.